Ladies and gentlemen, I'm much pleased tonight to introduce Mr. Andrew Salmon, a fellow counselor of the Royal Asiatic Society Korean Branch, who will be speaking on a very interesting topic on the Korean War. Personally, I was 11 years old in 1950 when the Korean War broke out, and I have a vivid memory of the war. I recall crossing Han River on a pontoon bridge, built right under the first Han River Bridge. The metal surface was very slippery. It was December, late December 1950, and very cold day, and the surface of the pontoon bridge was very slippery. I held my mother's hand tight and crossed the river on a pontoon bridge and climbed up very steep hill leading to the main street in Noryangjin, and walked about 2-3 kilometers to Yongdeungpo station, where I encountered the contingent of British troops, tall, handsome, wearing a black beret, and also with the dozens of midget armed vehicles. Our family was very lucky to have a military vehicle, military trucks, and we went to south. First, went through half destroyed the south gate of a Suwon fortress. Anyway, is my story. We are very fortunate to have Andy Salmon, whose interest seems to be mainly history, especially conducting research on Korean War and writing about it. He wrote a few prize-winning books. To the last round, the epic bridge stand on the Indian River, Korea, 1951, which won Military Book of the Year Award in the United Kingdom in 2009, and also a Korean Wave Award at the National Assembly 2010, and also was named one of the top 10 books on Korea by the Wall Street Journal. He also wrote another book called Scorched Earth, Black Snow, Britain and Australia in the Korean War 1950. Last year he was honored by the Queen Elizabeth II with the what they call MBE, Member of the British Empire, last year. I congratulate you for that honor. His latest book was Modern Korea, All That Matters, which was published in 2015. He holds a BA from the University of Kent and Masters from the University of London School of Oriental and African Studies. So without further ado, let's welcome Andy with a big round of applause.
Hello, thank you very much indeed for that kind welcome. A couple of things. I've given this presentation once before, also in Seoul, and one of the ambassadors who attended that talk, I saw him later. I won't mention his name, okay? Because diplomats are meant to be diplomatic. This ambassador, after seeing this presentation, had an absolute shit fit. He was purple-faced with rage. As I said, I won't mention his name, but he is from the United States. I said, what the hell? What's wrong? He said, God damn it, Andy. I mean, looking at your presentation, you know, the Brits kind of won the Korean War by themselves, you know? You didn't need us to be there. We were just wasting our time. I said, that was the day that Trump won the election, so he probably wasn't in the best of moods. He was an Obama appointee. Actually, it's a very legitimate criticism. What I must have neglected to say the last time I gave this presentation was my personal research on the war has largely been with the British role in the war. So most of my images, most of my anecdotes are about the Brits. That having been said, the British were here from first to last, so that is one prism through which one can legitimately view the war. But for those Americans in the audience, I will indeed say that it is a fair criticism. For every single Briton who died here, 33 Americans died. They had a much larger troop strength than British, so fair enough. But as it happens, as you can hear from my accent, I'm British, my research has been on the Brits, so this is kind of the way I'll tell the story. The presentation I'm going to break down into two parts. The first part is basically going to be factual. What happened in the Forgotten War or the Unknown War? Because so many people reading the newspapers today are fully aware that the Korean War never really finished. It still rages to this day, albeit in a very different manner. But they don't actually know much about the war itself. So I'll give you a very, very quick tour of the Korean War, 51 to 53. That's the factual part of what I'm going to say. Then I'm going to swerve into personal opinion. I'll tell you who I think won the war, why I think that, and who I think lost the war, and why I think that. And that is entirely open to interpretation. And if we wish to have a heated debate with, you know, tomatoes being thrown up at me, you know, feel free, you know, cock your arms now. But let's start with the history. What actually happened in Korea? Of course, the Korean War started on 25th of June. It's believed to have actually started a couple of hours earlier, on the 24th of June, in Busan, when the North Koreans launched their attack with a ship full of commandos aiming to take the port of Busan in a coup de main. And that attack was narrowly averted by a South Korean patrol boat, which intercepted the ship, sank it at night, and thus Busan, right at this southeast corner of the peninsula, which was, of course, later the resupply point to which the Americans reinforced Korea, remained free and not under communist control. That's not widely known. What most people think of, as you said, it started on June the 25th, in the very early hours of the morning. And this was painted during that day. It was painted by the guy on the right, Kim Jong-un, who some of the older Koreans here will know as Kobo-ul, a very famous cartoonist of the Park Chung-hee years. At the time, he was a 16-year-old newspaper artist, and he painted this little village here is now the sprawling city of Wijeonbu. And this road heading north-south is the famous Wijeonbu Corridor, one of the key invasion corridors into the heart of Seoul. And he painted this not realizing at the time the extraordinary catastrophe that was unfolding. But it's a really lovely picture. It's one of the few colour images of that early stage of the Korean War, and it repays study because this tells you a little bit about what would happen in Korea. Look at the landscape, the hills of Korea. It's a tough country to fight in. Mountains eat men in warfare. Look at the road. Most of the roads in Korea back in those days were unpaved. They were dirt tracks. So again, not a great country to fight in for a mechanized army. Look at the village. You can't really see the details, but of course Korean villages back in the day were largely wood wattle and thatch, those very, very poor old rural hanoks. And of course this had unpleasant consequences for the inhabitants when war began, because just one trace around will almost, in hot weather, will literally ignite the entire village. But anyway, this is Kobo-ul watching the North Korean artillery strikes hitting the hills, not realizing North Koreans are barreling down across the DMZ in armored columns heading for Seoul. And he told me when he painted this, he's still very, very angry about that day, because news was now coming in over the radio from Ri Sung-man's government saying, don't worry, the North Koreans have launched an all-out attack, but we'll defeat them. The theory in the South Korean army at that time was, we'll have, we'll have breakfast in Kaesong, lunch in Pyongyang, and dinner in Sinuiju. We'll win the war in a day. Of course, this didn't happen. So now the disaster begins. You're a pretty educated audience. I'm not going to talk about the pre-political situation. I think you know that Korea was cut in half by the great powers. This gentleman takes power in the north. This gentleman takes power in the south. Of course, these two never met. If they ever had met, one of them would probably have been dangling from a rope. And on the 28th, the North Korean army enters Seoul. The South Korean army at that time had not been fully armed by the Americans. The Americans didn't trust Ri Sung-man with heavy artillery, armor, or many aircraft, because they thought, probably quite correctly, that as soon as he had those things, he would launch his own invasion of the north to reunify the peninsula. But Kim beat him to the punch, and Stalin had, after much arm twisting from Kim, his subordinate, had actually armed North Korean People's Army with some good weaponry. Top right, T-34, the best tank of World War II, arguably the most important weapon in human history. This is the weapon that defeated Hitler on the Eastern Front. And he had two brigades of those, a very, very good tank, particularly for a peasant army, very simple to use, almost like a tractor. The Spargan submachine gun, the bird gun, every Korean War veteran you speak to who's in infantry will remember the sound of this gun. It's called the bird gun because the sound it makes is almost like an angry belch, a kind of brrrr sound. It fires so quickly, the predecessor to the Kalashnikov series of weapons. And again, some of the artillery, armored cars, some of the North Korean officers have been fighting with Mao Zedong in China for years, were very, very competent professionals, knew what they were doing, and they're armed with this good gear. But again, look at some of the rear echelon, the logistics. This is a panzer wagon, the old Soviet logistic tail, camouflaged against top cover, against US aircraft, pulled by a bullock. Again, quite a good piece of equipment for somewhere like Korea, but very, very vulnerable once the US Air Force arrives. And of course, as we know, the US Air Force and the US forces do come in very, very quickly. They come in under the aegis of the United Nations. Why the UN? Simply because at that time, China was not in the UN. Taiwan still held the Chinese seat on the UN Security Council. The Russians were protesting this and therefore had boycotted the UN. This gave the Americans free rein to move very quickly and effectively and launch a UN operation. And it is to this day arguably the most effective UN military operation ever launched. But let's not fool ourselves, it was an American-led operation under Douglas MacArthur in Tokyo. And the doughboys soon arrived from Japan. The Americans go into battle because by now the South Korean army is collapsing in the face of this mass offensive. And it seems that the situation is critical. And rather to everybody's surprise, at this stage of the war, only the Americans, then the Brits and the Australians arrive in those first few months. But the North Koreans are very, very effective. The Americans motoring north are defeated by the North Koreans. Kim Il-sung's greatest victory, which is apparently taught in military academies in places like Pyongyang and possibly Plovdiv, which was the fall of Taejong, the great marshal's great victory. There's some question as to whether Kim Il-sung actually did come south. It seems unlikely, but it's possible. But anyway, the Americans, rather to their surprise, find that their troops have been in Japan for so long and haven't really been training, don't have the brain of the army, which is the Corps headquarters, and are getting all the worst officer cadets from the US, all the best officer cadets, go to the European continent. The Americans are being forced back by the North Koreans. And so by late July, early August, the UN are really just holding one perimeter, and they've got two major towns, all that's left of South Korea. That, of course, Daegu and Busan. And this now becomes known as the Busan perimeter. And it becomes a race to reinforce. The North Korean People's Army, virtually their entire army now, is deployed, breaking their teeth on the American defenses and the rock defenses. And the Americans are furiously reinforcing. And this is the first British soldiers to arrive on the Nakdong River front. If you look in the background, that's enemy territory. There's a North Korean division dug in into those hills. And the guys, again, told me something I didn't know, which if we go back to the Yongpyong Island shelling in 2010, you may recall those the artillery North Koreans used. Some of it were rocket launchers. Some of it was literally dug into caves in the hills. And these guys said it was exactly the same back in 1950. The North Korean artillery was dug into the hillside, so you couldn't use counter-battery fire, you couldn't hit them with aircraft. So pretty smart army, the North Koreans. And fighting rages throughout that summer. And of course, the collateral damage, a term which didn't exist back in 1950, is absolutely immense, particularly when the Americans bring in their most horrific munition. This is a combination of naphtha, which is an incendiary, and palm oil, which makes it into a gel, makes it sticky. It burns about 800 degrees, like eight times hotter than boiling water. And of course, when this thing, the Americans called it a hell bomb in those days, hits a village, the whole village just flares up. And of course we know it today better, naphtha, palm oil, napalm. This is the first conflict in which this weapon is deployed. So fighting rages, again, you can see the state of the civilian population, and of course almost a classic Korean War image. Amid this devastation, women, many men have fled, children have been left alone, but the Korean family ties are still secure, and this is an image we see so often in these old photographs of a young girl with a tiny baby on her back, sister and brother, or brother and sister. And of course, much of the fighting in Korea is very, very close range. This is a North Korean guerrilla who's been killed. His own hand grenade exploded, took off his right and left arms. When you're within hand grenade range, that means you're probably within about the length of this room, because you can only throw a grenade a certain distance. So again, the North Korean army are very, very good at getting fighting up close and personal, where the UN air power and firepower can't be effectively used. And then comes the first stunning reversal of fortune in the Korean War. Thus far, it seems as if the North Koreans are winning. Suddenly, 15 September 1950, we discover the Marines, the US Marines, the best US ground troops in the war at this stage, have landed about 230 miles behind the North Korean front at Incheon. And this is MacArthur's greatest masterstroke. With one operation, he's reversed the tide of the Korean War. The North Korean army now have got the enemy right behind them, cutting off all their lines of communication. Virtually the entire North Korean force is deployed trying to break into Busan. Now the Marines are in Incheon and are fighting their way through into Seoul. And again, this gives you a perfect example of the close range of the combat. And that is probably one of the top 10 combat photographs taken in human history. It is extraordinarily rare for any photograph to show both friendly and enemy troops in one frame. I can think of maybe 10 examples ever taken. And this was a North Korean sniper. As they're advancing through the university district, through Sincheon, these Marines were being shot down from behind, and suddenly the light machine gun here turns around, fires a burst. You can see the dust going up, and North Korean sniper falling back. And that's at a range of about 5 meters. And that's pretty common for Korea. And yet, Seoul falls. The North Korean People's Army, one of the greatest mysteries of the Korean War. If I had a chance to speak to North Korean soldiers today in their 80s, this is the question I would ask them. How the hell did you guys, who have virtually all deployed around Busan in the distant south, manage to break contact with the Americans in Manchuria, where a lot of his heavy industry is, where Stalin has promised him heavy industrial investment, and so he has been infiltrating for about a month, about 250 to 300,000 troops into a 12 to 15 mile strip in the northern part of North Korea. And this is the greatest ambush of the 20th century. And it says something for the skill of these Chinese troops. They call themselves human bullets in a very dark, dark irony. Their skill at camouflage, concealment, concealed movement. They're a ghost army. We can't see them because they only move at night. They carry little umbrellas with foliage on them so they can't be spotted by air reconnaissance. And they're a ghost army because they're completely silent. They don't have radios, so we get no signals intelligence. They're literally a 19th century style army. They'll be using bugles, gongs to signal their movements. And of course, in Korea, where radios don't work very well, this is actually a pretty effective form of communications. And they call, they realize they're about to face massive firepower. So the Chinese troops call the Yalu crossing points on the Anok Gang the gates to hell. And this is them crossing over the frozen river in the late winter of 1950. And their tactics are very, very effective, very, very simple. You've probably heard it. It's called human wave. This is kind of what it looks like, although usually it takes place at night and the formation is much denser. What it is this. You have a UN position, which is normally on a hilltop, strong point, and behind it you'll have where my forearm is, a road. That's your resupply route. Your medical evacuations take place down here. Your ammunition resupply goes up here, and this is your hilltop, okay? What the Chinese will do is, under cover of darkness, they'll infiltrate columns of men to the foot of this position. And around 10, 11, 12, 1, they'll attack, and they'll try and overrun it with frontal assault. But while the frontal assault is pinning down all the guys in the strong point, they'll be infiltrating round the sides, down the road, setting up ambush columns, roadblocks on the road. So no ammunition resupply can get in, no wounded guys can be evacuated. So it's called human wave from Sun Tzu. Your attack must be like water. It'll either roll over the fence or trickle around it. And this proves to be a simple but highly effective tactic, almost a guerrilla blitzkrieg. And the UN force in North Korea is routed. This is the greatest American defeat anywhere in the world since World War II. This far surpasses any experience the Americans had in the longer and eventually bloodier war in Vietnam. This is the death ride of 2ID, 2nd Infantry Division in the Kunuri Pass. Nothing like this ever happened in Vietnam, where the Americans had so much firepower. What happens is a rock corps in the northeast disintegrates, an entire corps, two divisions. An American division, which is here in Korea to this day, the 2nd Infantry Division, tries to break out down a long, narrow road corridor. What they don't realize is it's a four-mile ambush. There are about 40 machine guns, 20 mortars, so you've got horizontal and vertical fire blocking the road. And the Americans, being a road-bound army at this point, instead of fighting through these blocks, try and bounce them in their trucks, and they get shot to pieces. And one of the British troops who's holding it open, the southern edge of the pass, remembers some of these guys coming through. He said, it reminded me of a 17th or 18th century naval battle, when the sides of the ships have been splintered and shot in with cannon fire. And you read about this in books, and there's blood pouring out of the scuppers. He said, that's what these trucks look like, piled high with dead and dying young Americans who just come through, literally, the gates of hell. And this is sort of the icing on the cake for the Chinese offensive. After this disaster, the entire UN force in North Korea is pretty much unmanned. And the retreat becomes a rout. It's known as the big bug out. To this day. And of course, tragic scenes, because as the UN forces are retreating, it's a scorched earth retreat. Everything useful for the enemy left behind will be destroyed. Villages, transportation hubs, education installations, food supplies, wells will be blown. Nothing will be left for the enemy. So about 700,000 Koreans hit the roads in this freezing winter. It's now minus 15, minus 20, colder than out there today, heading south, either because they don't want to be there when the communists return, or because they've got nowhere to go, their village has been blown. So tragedy, a Ville Dolorosa for the Korean people. One of the most gruesome stories from that time, of course, so many refugees were coming through on trains. Again, one of the British officers was in Seoul Station. He'd got out of the north, and he was waiting for his supply train to come through, and tens of thousands of Koreans were coming through on these trains. And some of the guys had strapped themselves to these trains because they couldn't hold on, so cold. And of course, from Pyongyang to Seoul, slow train, wind chill factor. So by the time this arrived in Seoul Station, virtually all the refugees hanging off it were dead. But amid this disaster, there was one heroic incident, and that was, of course, what many of you have heard of, the Battle of Chosin Reservoir up in the northeast. This is where the US Marines were deployed, and they fought against 8 Chinese divisions in a 70-mile breakout battle for the sea, and then evacuated from Hungnam in truly horrific conditions. The fact that they survived that operation is remarkable. And again, as they pulled out, everything was blown behind them. And that last image was the greatest man-made explosion since Nagasaki, that is, Hungnam docks being blown to bits on Christmas Eve 1950. So things are looking grim for the UN. North Korea has been lost within a matter of weeks. The Chinese have been undefeated. UN forces regroup in the south, wondering what will happen next. This is some of the British and Australian troops. They were the rear guard in the retreat from North Korea, the most dangerous position in a retreat. And they're in Wijongbu, the ruins of Wijongbu. and on midnight, they were having their New Year's party, drinking whiskey and beer from Japan, and they heard thunder rolling in the north. And of course, that wasn't thunder, it was artillery preparation. It's about 268,000 Chinese bayonets cross the frozen Injun River and attack south, the New Year's Day offensive. Again, UN forces retreat, the rock line crumbles, and this is somewhere just northwest of Seoul. Some of us were up there with the Irish Association a few weeks ago. This was one of the last areas in the line left, a battle called Happy Valley near Koyang, where the Royal Ulster Rifles, an Anglo-Irish unit, was decimated in a disastrous late-night combat. They were the last UN unit to pull back through Seoul. Seoul was burning at that time. The bridges across the Han were blown, but many refugees did manage to escape thanks to the activities of these Anglo-Irish soldiers who held off the enemy for one day. And this becomes the now famous 4th of January retreat, when Seoul is surrendered for the second time in the war to the communist forces. And fighting rages throughout that winter. Of course, this time the Chinese are now very, very far from their supply lines on the Yalu River. And for the first time, a battle called Chipyongni, French and American troops are surrounded by the Chinese. Instead of bugging out, they go into a hedgehog all-round offence. They're supplied by air, they've got air support, and they hold out against the Chinese. This is really the first time the Chinese have actually been held up or defeated. And this gives some new impetus, new motivation to the UN command. Fighting continues throughout the winter, and by March, the UN is back in Seoul. The Chinese, meanwhile, have done one of their disappearing acts again. The ghost army. They can literally fade into the landscape because they're invisible and inaudible. And by April, that horrible winter of war is over. Spring is sort of descending across the peninsula, and the war has kind of died down. The Chinese have disengaged, and the UN forces are probing forward, trying to find out what's going to happen next. What they don't realize, of course, is now what is today called the Armageddon north of Seoul, biggest communist attack. Not only of the Korean War, biggest communist offensive anywhere on earth since 1945, is about to be launched on about 10 o'clock at night on 22nd of April 1951. A third of a million troops want a breakthrough on both flanks of the UN command, annihilate the bulk of the American and Turkish forces. America will then be pushed out of the war, and Seoul will fall into communist hands again by May Day. That's the plan. And this is one of my favorite Korean War photographs. This was taken on that day. It was a Sunday, 22nd of April, 1951. It was taken in the morning when these two young officers from a British unit, the Gloucesters, were having a church service in an abandoned Confucian shrine, little knowing what would be bearing down on them, this massive juggernaut, this gigantic human wave after night fell on that day. And remarkably, both these men would receive Britain's highest award for gallantry. One was 22, one was 23, neither survived. It's a very, very rare picture of two heroes, not this time, but later, taken together. And that offensive was, in fact, defeated. That gives you some idea of the scale of the offensive. That's Wee Jong Moo. We're about here. This is a big attack, even by World War II standards. To give you some idea, the German offensive against Stalingrad deployed about 200,000 men. D-Day, the Allied invasion of Normandy, about 150,000 men. This is 300 plus thousand men. This is a big attack. But it's defeated. At the gates of Seoul, literally 5 miles north of Seoul. They can't keep to their timetable. They've lost too many casualties. So now the war again changes its face. Thus far, we've had the North Koreans race all the way down to Busan. The Americans counterattack in Incheon. We invade North Korea. We're pushed out of North Korea, south of Seoul. We recapture Seoul as the big attack. But from now on, and it's only late 1951, the war will become largely static, the Sitzkrieg. And this is when we get the phrase, the forgotten war. Because now, there's none of these big pushes up and down the peninsula. Both sides have very limited objectives. There's been too much blood shed for Korea. So now it becomes a fighting for hilltops along what is now pretty much the DMZ. night battles, artillery duels, patrol raids, almost like World War I in Korea on mountains. And this is bloody, unpleasant, drooling, traumatic, but it's not dramatic. There's no cavalry charges, there's no airborne attacks. So this is when the global media kind of lose interest in Korea. And this is when we get the phrase, the forgotten war, because even while it was being fought, the war was kind of forgotten by the Western publics. And again, this is one of the famous positions like Old Baldy, Heartbreak Ridge, Sniper Ridge. This is the hook, or the bloody hook. This has been hit by Chinese artillery. These trenches, which had been like 8 feet deep by the end of the artillery barrage, were about 6 inches deep. And a lot of Korean hills all along the DMZ were just churned to pieces. Literally, the topography changed through so much shell fire striking. And then finally, on midnight, 27th July, 53, the guns do fall silent. An armistice against Syngman Rhee's wishes has been signed. And that's pretty much where we are today. The peace agreement was never actually made. Officially, as we all know from every newspaper account we read these days, the Korean War continues. But of course, as I hope that sort of shows you, the war was utter carnage, possibly 2 million people dead in 3 years. The number of people killed since this armistice is in the hundreds. So in fact, the armistice is a great thing. It has held pretty effectively, albeit there's no peace treaty. And of course, the DMZ, as we all know, remains in place, the bamboo curtain across the Korean Peninsula, the most impenetrable border on the face of the earth, I think. And as people point out, there's no real reason for this border to be here. It's not a geographical barrier. It's not a cultural barrier. It's just a line on a map. So what a tragedy. So why was the Korean War so utterly horrific? Why is it that so many veterans, I mean, I've spoken to people 60 years later, can't turn their lights off at night. They still have nightmares. What made this war so gruesome? Well, one thing, of course, is the weather. Korea, as we know, once we step outside the door, is very, very cold. The winter of 50-51 was the coldest in living memory. So it's a very, very cold, very unpleasant place to fight. This was after Chip Yong-ni. These guys have been killed sleeping in their sleeping bags. Their sleeping bags are literally frozen up, and the Chinese came along and just killed them all. The terrain is extremely rough. Everybody here has been hiking. I guess most of you have in Korea, knows how rough the Korean terrain is. And again, if you've got to carry ammunition up these hills, if you've got to carry wounded down these hills, if you're wounded and you've got to get down these hills, it's pretty unpleasant. And of course, it was a civil war. And let's not fool ourselves. Civil wars are the least civil forms of war. This is a very romantic sort of statue which is up in the war memorial. And it, certainly, it's very, very poignant. Brother meets brother on the battlefield. But usually when brother fights brother, you know, they tear each other to pieces. Civil wars are particularly brutal. And did you recognize that? Yeah. And of course, Korea, let's not fool ourselves. And these happy days of friendly young Koreans and the Korean wave and this global society, this democratic society we now live in. Korea back in 50 to 53 was an extremely brutal country. It had been brutalized by Japanese colonialism. It had been brutalized by the ideological war fought by Koreans in Kim Il-sung's guerrilla bands, by Koreans in the Japanese army in Manchuria in the 30s. Ideological divisions have been polarized during and just after the colonial period. And again, it's easy to forget these days when everyone's talking just about comfort women, how brutal the Korean reputation was in World War II. The Japanese, rather like the Russians and the Germans with the Ukrainians, gave the Koreans the worst jobs in their empire. They were the opium dealers. They were the brothel managers. They were the POW camp guards. They were the counterinsurgency units. All the nasty jobs is what the Japanese gave the Koreans. So the Koreans had a bad reputation. And when Ian Fleming wrote Goldfinger, his villain was a Korean. And at that time, if you read it now, it sounds almost racist, but he says, you know, the cruelest, most brutal, most unpleasant people on this world are Koreans. And the odd job, of course, was this Korean villain. Although, ironically, he was played by a Japanese, Henry Salmon. It was brutal because it was superpower clash, communism versus democracy, if you can call South Korea democracy. These are American POWs who were killed by the North Koreans getting the last rites from a chaplain after their position's been taken. Some have got their hands tied behind their backs. And of course, the Koreans themselves were killing each other, not necessarily for ideological reasons. This is one of Cobell's paintings in Chongno after the Americans had retaken the city. I said, you know, who's this unfortunate character? He said, well, this isn't someone who was killed for ideological reasons. He wasn't a soldier. You know, during the fighting, the Chongno gangsters, the infamous Chongno gangsters, were filling each other in under cover of war. So there was a lot of murder going on during the war. And of course, the South Korean government was probably just about as bad as the North Korean government in those days. It didn't start the war, that's certainly true, but in terms of killing civilians, who killed the most, I would like to say. This was a massacre which was blamed on the communists through most of the 50s and 60s, 70s. Only in the 80s did it become clear that this massacre in Taejon, in the prison, was carried out by South Korean police. This was total war. And of course, the weapons were particularly horrific. We mentioned napalm and how the villages went up, and the horrific scars caused by those who were actually drenched in this stuff. The keloids raised on the skin, you wouldn't really want to look at it. And of course, let's be really honest, this was Jim Crow America. This was Korea, a brutal, poor, unknown nation. Many UN soldiers did look down upon the Koreans. They called them gooks at the time, which of course later became a racial pejorative. And this, as some of you probably recognize, is down in Nogin-ri, where Korean civilians were, in a case which is still unclear, massacred by retreating, possibly panicky, American troops. So yeah, there were killings by Koreans, by UN troops. And I'll finish this section with Picasso's famous painting, which shows the Korean conflict. And it just shows the forces of militarism, be they North Korean, South Korean, and of course the real victims being the civilians. So, a pretty nasty war. And a forgotten war, as I've said. Some people call it the unknown war. I think that's just being pedantic. It's not a known war, it's not a remembered war. Why not? I was war in human history, 60 million people dead. For British, for Europeans, this was a war of national existence, an existential war. We had no choice but to fight this war. And of course then, 65, arguably earlier, the Vietnam War kicks off, America's first TV war, the Technicolor War, the Rock and Roll War. In May, and we've got a Vietnam veteran here tonight. And I think he'll agree, this is probably a more, how can I say, glamorous war than Korea. And of course, that captured the American imagination because it was such a trauma for the American political psyche. So Korea falls into the cracks between these two wars and never really got out to the other side. Moreover, of course, where do we get our understanding of history from these days? Not from people like me, certainly not from history teachers. We get it from popular culture, right? And of course, World War II was captured in some superb films. We've all seen Bridge on the River Kwai. Many of you will have seen that incredible film by Klimov, Come and See, possibly the greatest war movie ever made, traumatic but brilliant, about Belarusia during World War II. And of course in Vietnam as well, spawned some superb art, Full Metal Jacket, Platoon, Apocalypse Now. Show me a great Korean war movie, if you can, I haven't seen it. Likewise, literature, World War I, the tragic war poets, World War II, classics like Grossman, again, the greatest Russian novel of the 20th century. Guy Sage, the choir on the Western Front of World War II. And of course, the Holocaust spawned, you know, great traumas, great art. And Wiesel, Levi, and the extraordinary novel by Jonathan Littell, The Kindly Ones. This is, by any standard, great literature. Show me some great literature about the Korean War. Again, if it exists, I haven't read it. So it's forgotten, or it's unknown. But, you know, looking back, who won it? And how do we define victory or defeat? I would say the key victor of the Korean War, the guys who benefited the most, were of course Japan. Japan didn't fight in Korea. It did actually have some naval units off Korea, and some of the Incheon landing marines were carried by Japanese crewing their landing craft, but not wearing uniforms. But basically, Japan was not a combatant. But of course, having a war next door to you is pretty good for your economy. And the Japanese economic boom kind of starts to take off in the late 40s and 1950, you can see it starts flying. So the Americans are pouring money into their rear echelon. Their rear echelon is Busan, and the funnel leads through to Japan. So Japan does very well out of the Korean War, ironically the same way that Korea would do very well out of the Vietnam War 10 years later. The other victor, I'd say, was China. China lost 186,000 men killed in Korea. That's a lot of people, but of course China's not a democracy. China's got a big population. And I would argue that China, this is when we see the rise of a superpower. Today we talk about China as an economic superpower, but back in 1950, people were seeing China as a military colossus. Again, let's look back into recent Chinese history, the famous sign that's alleged to have hung in the park in Shanghai, hung up by colonial authorities and protectorate courts. No dogs, no Chinese allowed. China was humiliated for 100+ years. And again, let's not forget the Opium Wars, the Sino-Korean War, the Sino-Japanese War, the Boxer Rebellion, then the Second Sino-Japanese War. Again, in each of these wars, China is beaten, humiliated, defeated. Only in Korea does China finally stand up. That extraordinary victory, this peasant army wins in North Korea in winter 1950, has never been forgotten by China. I would argue for good reason. And of course, China now still is the guarantor of the North Korean state. The state it saved in 1950. And again, something which many Korean leftists tend not to remember is the fact that the UN forces, the Americans, basically, had pretty largely reunified Korea in late 1950. It was the Chinese who changed the scene and why we have the tragedy that continues to this day. But China, acting as all nations do in their own interests, secured North Korea as a buffer state against Japan, South Korea, America, for perpetuity, thus far at least. So who lost the Korean War? Ask the 2 million dead, stretching from Busan to Manchuria. I would say the US. Why? Of course America didn't lose. America wasn't facing an existential threat from Korea. But this was the first war America couldn't win. If you read the speech by General Mark Clark that he gave on signing the armistice, he was acutely aware he was the first American general to sign an armistice agreement where America had not been victorious. And this became rather traumatic for America. But arguably, it set a really, really bad precedent for the future. Because Korea became a limited war. America kind of lost the will to win it. They weren't willing to spill enough blood, spend enough gold to go all the way and reunify Korea. And of course, this was repeated in Vietnam. America bombed North Vietnam, but never counter-invaded it, arguably because of the disaster they encountered when they invaded North Korea, which of course would be the only free world invasion of a communist state during the Cold War. And of course, there's an enormous legacy from the Korean War, more so than from World War II, more so than from World War I, more so, I'd say, than from Vietnam. Because America had previously disarmed after its wars. It was only after the Korean War that America decided it would not disarm again. So the military-industrial complex, which is now so critical, so powerful, is a direct legacy, not of Vietnam, but of Korea. And that's an extraordinary legacy. And of course, North Korea also lost. They didn't achieve their war aims. Let's not make any bones about it. Let's not be taken in by some of the arguments you'll sometimes read that both states were responsible for the Korean War. No, North Korea invaded South Korea. That is plain and inarguable. And they weren't successful in their war aims. North Korea ended up devastated, still divided, and of course it's incredibly distrustful of the wider world to this day, much to the detriment of the North Korean people. So take a look at what North Korea is today. It's an ultra-nationalistic state, it's an ultra-militarized state, and it worships a family of god kings. What state does this sound like? North Korea, since the Korean War, has become the state it hated and despised the most, which of course was Imperial Japan. This is what North Korea, in a political sense, now looks like. And again, that's difficult to argue with. So what makes North Korea, you know, relevant today? I mean, as my colleagues down here, you know, freelance journalists, we all make good money out of this. Thank you, Kim family. But the only reason that North Korea really is relevant today is the story it creates. Nuclear weapons, strategic missiles, a human rights tragedy, and abuse of human rights. It's difficult to find a good story in North Korea. So those are the winners, those are the losers, in my opinion. Okay, this is not written in stone. Who won the peace? That, I would argue, was South Korea, strongly backed by the United States, for better, sometimes for worse. Economic miracle, again, very much underwritten by Japan and by America. It's kind of forgotten these days. The Japanese supplied $800,000 in soft loans and reparations. Sorry, $800 million, sorry. Thank you. In reparations and soft loans. Vietnam, the Vietnam War delivered to South Korea thanks to their role in fighting, about $1 billion. This was far, far, far more money than the Koreans themselves would earn, working very, very hard, for example, in construction in the Middle East. So that was the seed money for the economic miracle. Again, when we think of Park Chung-hee as a dictator, certainly to this day he was a dictator, no question, politically. But the fact that he reversed centuries of poverty, disease, created an industrial base for this country, to my mind, means he is much more than a dictator. And in that, in his economic efforts, he was largely supported by the US in terms of loans, in terms of consulting, in terms of technology transfer, and of course, in terms of most favored trading nation status. Koreans themselves created their own political miracle. There's no doubt about that. Let's not fool ourselves into thinking that South Korea was a real democracy before 1987. Again, was there an American hand behind this? Did the Americans tell Chun-doo-won to stand down his troops who were on alert for 4 hours to go in and suppress the protests in Seoul? Maybe create a giant Gwangju? Very possibly. And of course today, the social miracle, the massive changes to Korean culture, the gentler, kinder, happier society that Koreans are forging or trying to forge today, is the third sort of arm of the Korean miracles, which we've seen. I'd argue South Korea is the greatest national success story of the late 20th century. And of course, a lot of it was underwritten by the US alliance. So what's the lesson that Korea teaches us, South Korea teaches us? Well, you know, again, why is all this important? I mean, Korea provides a really, really good model, a really good benchmark for developing nations. If you ignore the sort of the classic Anglo-Saxon prescription, which is open markets, laissez-faire government, Korea did it a very, very different way. And yet, it was very, very successful. This top-down economic model did work. And it's rather to my surprise that more nations don't take advantage of the Korean lesson. What's the lesson for the Western alliance? In these days of Syria and Iraq and Afghanistan, what does the Korean War teach us? I would argue this is the biggest lesson that we as Western and Korean Democrats should learn from Korea. It's this: when you fight a war, you don't cut and run. If you fight a war, if you win it, or you just fight to a stalemate, you don't leave your ally in the lurch. You make a long-term investment. And we've seen it work very, very successfully. In West Germany, there are still American troops, still a massive American economic presence in West Germany. We saw it to an extent with the British in Malaysia, or Malaya at the time in Singapore. The British didn't just leave after independence, they stayed and fought the communist insurgency, supported the country long term. We've seen it with the Americans in Japan, again, who turn around that raw, war-ravaged nation, an atomic bomb nation, and created a successful democracy, a very successful economy. And of course, we've seen it with South Korea. A long-term investment, a long-term engagement, a long-term commitment. That is the lesson that Korea teaches us. What's happened in the years since in terms of American foreign policy? Well, remember Vietnam, pulling out of Vietnam, and look what's happening in the Middle East now after we went into Iraq, fought a war, and then lost the peace, and ISIS was created. It's a direct result of that. This isn't failed foreign policy. This is successful foreign policy. It doesn't take years. It takes decades. Do Western democracies to this day have that kind of patience? I don't know. So, does Korea matter? I would argue, yes, it still matters. It's central to one of the most important industrial and economic areas in the world, Northeast Asia. After North America, Western Europe, Northeast Asia is where everything's happening. This is where the future lies. And this is where there are so many conflicting interests. And the Korean Peninsula, to this day, remains not just an economic black hole in the north, separating South Korea from the Asian mainland. It's a potential causus belli for Armageddon. And that is a truly frightening thought, that this war, which really did finish in 1953, could to this day reignite and in population-dense, target-rich Northeast Asia, everything could go very, very badly wrong. But I'll leave you with this thought. This is what one of the veterans I spoke to said. He returned to Korea 50 years after the war, and he said, I'll read it to you, "What do giving and loving have in common? They're the same." It's a pretty germane thought. 50 years ago, I gave a year of my life to Korea. I nearly lost it in battle. I hadn't realized until I came back 50 years later to this devastated land. I hadn't realized what the Koreans had done. But I felt their gratitude and what they'd done with their wonderful new nation. I wanted to say, don't thank me. It's you who've made my life worthwhile. It's you who've magnified me. That's all. Thank you.
Andy can entertain a few questions from the floor. So, anybody?
What is the most ferocious battlefield in Korea when North invade South and Allied force move North to defeat them?
Off top of head, I would say the fighting around the Pusan perimeter was the fiercest fighting. That went on for 2 months. That was army-scale fighting. Horrific, particularly for the North Koreans, of course, who were being bombarded from all sides. Oh, thanks. As we headed north, probably inside North Korea, Changjin-ho, Chosun Reservoir, one US Marine division against eight Chinese divisions, in temperatures colder than Stalingrad, in mountains higher than Monte Cassino, 70-mile fight to the sea. That's pretty horrific for the men who were there. Yeah.
So, anybody?
Just a question about perspective. What do you think in South Korea today, the perspective of the war, or the narrative, is really about 6/25 war? It's all about the starting of it. That seems, in my opinion, to kind of cloud discussion of why the war happened. It also seems to kind of avoid discussion about the failure to negotiate between the two Koreas to this day. This, the message here is all about 6/25 war, and then it kind of stops. What's your opinion?
I mean, I respectfully disagree. I think that's just the nomenclature. That's just the name of the war. That's an Asian format for naming events. We call it the Korean War. They call it the 25th of June War. To me, that's just a name. Why is it forgotten here? why is any war forgotten anywhere? When you become a rich, successful, prosperous society, you look forward, you don't look back. History is poorly taught in most nations. I would say in Korea it's very, very poorly taught, very, very biased. In Northeast Asia, arguably, history is not taught for the sake of history. It's taught for the sake of national messaging, or should I say nationalistic messaging. There's a reason for that, and the war doesn't fit into that nationalistic narrative terribly well, because it started off as a civil war. So to me, it's surprising that Koreans pay far, far more attention to the colonial period as a national trauma, when during the colonial period, unpleasant and humiliating as it may have been, the number of deaths was tiny compared to what happened in just 3 years in Korea. Korea's lifespans increased during the colonial period. The Korean population increased during the colonial period, and that was 35 years. During the Korean War, you've got, no one really knows, but the best estimate is about 2 million people killed in the space of 3 years. That's a massive national trauma. But yeah, it's not taught. Doesn't fit the narrative. Popular culture. It's not a sexy subject for popular culture. Off the top of my head, that's my response.
Any other question? No question? No. Okay.
For your statistics about after the war and Korea's development and the contribution made by the U.S., I would beg to differ because I was here.
Sure, okay. Sorry. Go ahead.
This one advantage of being this age. The amount of money that, first of all, American foreign aid stopped in 1960, led to a collapse of the Korean economy and the recession massive, which sparked the, as you know, the popular revolution against Syngman Rhee. The money that the Japanese gave in their settlements is peanuts, absolute peanuts in terms of national development. The amount of money, yes, there was good money made during Vietnam, but the effect on the Korean economy in Vietnam was much more expertise for the management of construction companies, logistic companies, and the rest, not so much the cash that was earned. Indeed, the major infrastructural and industrial development funding was overwhelmingly by loans, domestic as well as international, not so much by assistance. The major contribution made by the U.S. was exactly what you said, and bravo for it, with the parallels. It was providing a stability by the continuous military presence, removing from the national psyche a constant fear of, oh my God, what if they invade tomorrow thing. That I think is the single greatest aspect, and perhaps giving some of Korea's dictators pause for thought,
right,
that we can't go too far. Yeah, only if they'd done it in 79 with Jung Gwan's coup, which they did not, but
I would take your point. Let me just come back with a couple of points. I would say the Western alliance, as well as Japan, the Europeans, the Western Europeans, as well as the Americans, in terms of tech transfers, in terms of consulting. I mean, you're very familiar with the role of the Brits in the shipbuilding industry. The Americans and Japanese had a big role in the car industry. The Japanese had a big role in the steel industry. I think everybody had a big role in the petrochemical industry, and so on and so forth. So those technology and knowledge transfer. In terms of peanuts, I would have thought $800 million back in 65 was the biggest tranche of capital South Korea had ever had. Likewise, the Vietnam War, over 10 years, that's $1 billion in direct payments for the use of troops. That's big money in those days.
$800 million.
There was $1 billion, that's the best figure, about $1.2-1.3 billion was the price of the South Korean involvement in Vietnam. On top of that were all the companies which went there and as you just said, made a great deal of money. Another point I'd make about the war and about arguably the American military presence is the knowledge transfer. You know, I mean, Hyundai started off repairing jeeps for US, you know, US troops on US bases. Chung Ji-young was hired by the UN forces to rebuild Pyongyang airfield, but then the Chinese arrived, so that never happened. A lot of the early Chebol got their, you know, their start in international business through the US military. So, I mean, you could go on. I think there's a pretty significant contribution by the Americans. Not all of it, which is easy to actually quantify.
I agree yeah. somewhat. On the other hand, the automotive industry, the know-how and all that, they have loans and they pay for it. For the shipbuilding, they hired A&P Appledore Newcastle upon Tyne, they had loans and they paid cash for it. And that's a different thing than, you know, people coming and investing. And there was a very big hesitance, you know, to have foreign investment because of the Japanese period. So I'm sorry to argue with you, but it's so much fun.
Okay. Well, we'll agree to it.
One more?
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, God. Let's have this discussion.
I take the point that was just made about the importance of the security umbrella, if you will.
Sure.
And I think if you're trying to tote up the benefit, you have to somehow monetize that. You can't just say, oh, we got this nice security envelope.
Yeah.
Also, it's a little frivolous to sort of start the clock running in 1960 instead of 1950. And if you look at the decade of the 50s, in today's dollars, the U.S. primarily, with some contributions from other allied parties, pumped in today's dollars about $25 billion worth of cash into the Korean economy at a time when they weren't capable of paying for anything. So the view of how much the monetary value of it was has to be substantially revised from what was just stated.
I mean, Kent, don't talk to me, talk to Peter. I would agree with you.
That puts you in the fire.
Yeah.
Yeah,
sure.
So, you mentioned there's not much literature, books and movies about the Korean War. Hopefully you read to that. But like, still, like, there were lots of survivors of the war, and there were lots of war journalists in Korea during wartime. So I wonder, like, would you like to further elaborate on the reason for such unpopularity of the Korean War in the media, like in the cinema, literature world, and also would there be any possibility that any movies or books about this war, like the Korean issue, would be coming up in the future, like in the Hollywood and other things? And would you suggest any idea of like how to make that happen?
Yeah, I mean, we can talk about this for days.
You forgot about the movie Into.
Okay. I'll talk about two movies, American movies. The greatest American movie flop ever made, at least up until recent years, was the Unification Church-funded movie about the Incheon Landing, Incheon, which Jacko's Wet Sloop very kindly gave me a copy of a year or two ago at this very location. So that was a disaster for movie making. You want to make a Korean War movie? Remember Incheon. They lost, you know, millions of bucks on it. And they had, what, Laurence Olivier, Jacqueline Bisset, all-star cast. But there were, you're right, there were some. The Manchurian Candidate was meant to be about Korea, about the brainwashing aspect of it, which we now know that POWs weren't brainwashed. They were harangued. It was a very, very inefficient process. But if you look at, say, North Korea today, I think brainwashing does work to some extent on the Korean Peninsula, so maybe it's more germane than we thought at the time. The other one, of course, is...
MASH.
MASH, yeah. Now, MASH was actually a very good piece of art. You know, it was a great movie and a very good TV series, but it came out during the Vietnam War, and so it was set in Korea, but the issues and the sort of the conscience of the series was really Vietnam, not Korea. So it's just set in Korea as a convenience. And of course, back in the day, a lot of Koreans actually got pretty pissed off about MASH because it's filmed in Malibu. And people were saying, you know, this doesn't look much like war-torn Korea. I think the reason is simply, as I said, between the greatest war in history, and between the Vietnam War, the most televised war in history at the time, Korea fell between the gaps, a classic case of Korea being a shrimp between two whales.